Great. Thank you, everybody, for joining us today for this special CCC OER Open Education Week presentation, The Advantages of Using OER Among the Disadvantaged, presented by Dr. Tanja Connerly. Thank you for joining us here today. Can you skip to the next slide, Liz? So I'm just going to take a quick overview of the agenda. We are just doing a CCC overview. We will have the advantages of using OER among the disadvantaged by Tanja Connerly, an overview of the EDI Summer Book Club and upcoming CCC OER events, and how to stay in the loop with CCC OER. So CCC OER is a community of practice for open education. We provide resources, support, and opportunities for collaborators from learning, planning, and implementing successful open educational programs at community and technical colleges. Thank you, Liz. OE Global is in its 11th year of hosting Open Education Week, and it keeps growing each year with your help. You can contribute in so many ways. You can host an event, share open assets, engage in conversations on OEG Connect, attend events, and promote OE Week in your own network. Don't forget about the promotional toolkit and templates and advertising for OE Week activities on campus or digitally. So those are available on the website. And now I'm pleased to announce our guest speaker for the day. I'm pleased to announce Dr. Tanja Connerly is a sociology professor at San Jacinto College in Houston, Texas. She created the Houston Area OER Consortium in June of 2017. This organization consists of Houston, Galveston area colleges meeting to discuss the OER industry and how they can assist each college on reaching their OER goals. She is an Open Ed Conference board member. She is also the senior contributing author to OpenStack's Introduction to Sociology, 3rd edition, and past co-chair of the EDICCC OER committee, and currently a CCC advisory emeritus. She has presented numerous OER presentations and publications on topics pertaining to OER and EDI. So I want to give a warm welcome to Tanja. We're so grateful to have you here presenting with us today. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Andrea, and thank you, Wade, and thank you, Liz, for having me. I miss my family. Today, I am going to present a topic pertaining to the disadvantaged group. Can you guys see my slides okay before I start? You're good? Okay, perfect. When I was working on my dissertation, I found additional research that was pertaining to other minority groups. We tend to focus on just the minority group of race pertaining to open educational resources and how much money that we're saving via textbook to our minority group. But I think that we need to keep in mind that when OER was coined in 2002, that it was basically a organization and a community that was focused upon equity for all, not just for one group of people. And in 2020, we had a resurgence or a resurface, not we, the OER community, but our country did after the murder of George Floyd. It was like a social injustice. So everybody got on the bandwagon in reference to equality. But guys, we need to commend ourselves that we have always had this focus in reference to equity and equality. So today, what I would like to do is bring additional attention to other disadvantaged or minority groups, such as women and the population over 40. Not ignoring racial inequalities at all, but again, I think that we need to be able to address other minority groups as well. With that in mind, I believe that we have to first define a topic before we literally talk about it. So when we talk about the disadvantaged group, we're literally talking about and discussing people who have less of a chance of success due to different barriers. So therefore, they're unable to achieve a successful life. There is a theorist by the name of Robert Merton. Robert Merton said that in our society, that our goal is financial success. That's the reason why we have immigrants that come to the States. That's the reason why we work as hard as we do. And he said that there's two things that can basically obtain this financial success, and that's hard work and education. And unfortunately, this minority group that we're speaking of, just two of these minority groups, there's many people that will fall in this disadvantage or minority groups, that unfortunately they are unable to meet this success because of the barriers. The minority groups are basically going to be characterized, or I should say the people who fall in this category, they meet these five characteristics. They receive unequal treatment and less power over their lives than anyone. They have distinguishable physical or cultural traits, like their skin color may distinguish them apart from everyone, or their language. They have involuntary membership. That means that they're born into it. They can't do anything about it. And they have awareness of their subordination. So that means that society makes them aware that they are insubordinate. And they have a high rate of in-group marriage, meaning they marry within their group. Another characteristic that's not listed by Wagley and Harris that I've found out during my research is that just because a person is a part of a minority group, unfortunately, does not have anything to do with size, because our Latino and our Hispanic population is the largest growing population that we have, but it has to do with who has the power. With that being said, we are going to now address who are the disadvantaged. We're going to look at the racial and ethnic minorities. We're going to discuss women and the population over the age of 40. During our presentation today, there will be questions that I will ask you to address in the chat. And Andrea is going to look at the chat and be able to respond to these questions and help me along the way. First of all, when we talk about race, guys, you need to know that race is a physical characteristic. So when we're talking about race, we're looking at the African-American people, we're looking at our Asian population, we're looking at our Native American population, because race, again, is distinguished by physical characteristics. While we have ethnicity, on the other hand, is going to be looking at our Latino population, our Arab population, and what we call white ethnicity, meaning like the Polish, our Irish, our Jewish population. With that in mind, I would like for you just to put in the chat, knowing what I've given you, the information that I've given you pertaining to the disadvantaged and the minority population, what are some acts during history that have happened that has contributed to making race a factor and making race a minority or disadvantaged group? So if you just can put that in the chat for us, and if you have any idea, that's just a little, tidbit I thought that we could talk about and discuss. Andrea, let me know if you have any responses in reference to that.
Okay, great. It looks like here we've got World War II internment camps.
Very good, very good. These are the things that we're looking for, and basically that's distinguishing race. Genocide, we're looking at the Native Americans here in the United States. We're looking at the Muslims and the Serbs. We're looking at Holocaust. All of these are racial factors. Another disadvantaged group that we are going to look at and address is women. When we talk about women, this is going to be something that's based upon our sex. Now, at this time, we're only going to address male and females. I know that we are now where we're addressing transgender and other sexual orientations, but today we're just going to look at biological. And again, I know that we can have intersex as well, so I don't want anyone to think that I'm ignoring any of our transgender population or anything, because I'm not. But in reference to women being a part of the disadvantaged group, you may ask, when did all of this occur? Well, remember that our first society that was created was a hunter and gatherer society. In this society, men did the hunting, women did the gathering, but believe it or not, they were equal because their roles were defined, they were very important. So therefore, there was no inequality during this time period. The inequality in our society basically came about during our horticulture and our agrarian society. This is because our population literally started to grow. So the woman's role now was more in the home, taking care of the children. You didn't see basically a resurgence of this until like the late 1800s came about. And you had the first feminist movement that came about. And then after that, you had your World War II, where women literally had to go back out into the workforce. And they were working during this time period. And they were like, we like doing this. We like being out of the house. We like working. So, but the man had already established his role in society. And society has already said that that is the dominant force. That is the dominant race. I mean, that is the dominant sex is going to be male. So that pretty much is how the transition came about in reference to women becoming minorities. Because when society first is established, again, men and women were equal. Well, I've already given you some tidbits in reference to historically what contributed to the sex factor being categorized, women being categorized as a minority or a disadvantaged group. But does anybody else have any other history in reference to why women and how women became a part of the minority population?
Yes, we have quite a few entries here.
Awesome. Yeah.
I just want to identify that Wade did note in here on the previous screen, also Chinese Exclusion Act and other acts excluding immigrants from regions and countries. So that
exactly. Thank you, yes. Wade, for appreciating that. Thank you so much.
Yes.
Andrew, you have some more?
Yes. Overturning Roe v. Wade, not really historical. That was mentioned.
Yes, it is.
Yes. Lower wages for women, pregnancy issues in the workplace that men don't have with childcare.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And awesome. Then we have the Equal Pay Act.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Equal Pay Act is another act too. The bona fide occupational qualifications, same job, same pay is going to coincide with that too.
Right. And then Liz mentioned women's suffrage.
Yes. The women's suffrage movement. Thank you, Liz.
And
awesome.
Then another comment here from Wade, exclusion of women from higher education opportunities.
And we're going to get into that in just a second. Thank you, Wade, for that. Okay, so our last disadvantaged group, and guys, I know that there are many, many other minority or disadvantaged groups, but these are just three of them that as in our OER community, again, we always focus upon our minority groups and how we can help them in order to eliminate the barriers of textbook costs. But guys, we have many other organization and minority groups that we need to focus on as well. And our last group of people that we're going to look at in our presentation is our population over the age of 40. Someone already brought up our Age Discrimination Act, which basically makes it unlawful for a person to discriminate over the hiring or firing someone over the age of 40. And guys, believe it or not, 20% of our educational populations is over the age of 40, and they're returning back to school. There are several reasons that they're returning back to school. They are returning back to school in order to find better employment because they need additional expertise. They need a degree. They're returning back to the workforce because of promotion or a pay raise. And I was also reading an article today from Inside Higher Ed that our retirees are literally coming out of retirement. And because the retirement age has increased and they're not really ready to retire either. And so they're finding themselves going back to school in order to obtain more knowledge. Going back to exactly the previous questions that we talked about, we're just swapping in age. Is there some other acts that have happened historically in our society that has contributed to making age a factor? of people being a minority or disadvantaged group. Any comments pertaining to that one?
While we're waiting for that, I just want to acknowledge that Bridget had mentioned here in the chat, in Tanzania, various religions and tribal and national laws continue to treat women differently under law, for example, in inheritance.
Thank you for bringing that up. In the feminist movement, you have multicultural feminists, and multicultural feminists believe that if one woman is being oppressed, all women around the world are being oppressed. And so all of these, we have to keep abreast of all of these occurrences. With that being said, our next section is going to cover the advantages that OER can provide to others and this disadvantaged or minority group. But before we go to that slide, can you please write in the chat, how can OER provide advantages to these minorities and disadvantaged groups in our society? With the information that I've given you, can you tell me how else can OER provide advantages to our minorities and disadvantaged group in our society? And I'm hoping that your answers will be what I'm going to utilize to discuss in reference to OER advantages and disadvantages.
While we're waiting for people to make a response, Tanja, there's also another note here from Jacqueline, that baby boomers not being hired because it's assumed that they don't know technology, right? That is true for some, but not all.
That is so true. That is so true. And also they can get two for the price of one too, because if they hire somebody younger, they can train them in order to basically do what they need. And then they don't have to pay them as much too. That was in the article as well. Thank you, Jackie, for that contribution. Well, we've talked about the disadvantaged population in reference to the race, in reference to women and the population over the age of 40. Well, we already know the advantages that OER can bring about pertaining to education, but I also want us to highlight the advantages that OER can bring to employment as well. Dealing with education advantages that can help this minority and disadvantaged group, we already know that towards education, OER can save money through textbook costs. As of today, nearly $1 billion have been saved pertaining to textbook costs. In reference to education, guys, we are one of the leading innovators in reference to online teaching and learning. You know, the publisher, the traditional publishers are really following our lead in reference to online teaching and online learning, especially with having your textbooks on the first day of class because everything is online, especially with the teaching and the different pedagogies. This has been us from start. So keeping that in mind of us being an innovator, we have to continue to have that mindset. I think that, you know, we are at a point in reference to education that we keep repeating the same thing in reference to, you know, how much money we've saved in reference to textbook costs. But I think the pandemic has given us an indication that online learning and teaching is not going to go away. It is just going to continue to grow. And in order for us to continue to expand OER, we have to continue to grow with it as well. So that means that we have to continue to keep our innovative hat on. We have to partner with our instructional designers. We have to continue to partner with our librarians. We have to continue to market it at every level, starting at, you know, the president or the chancellor of our college on down. So with that being said, in reference to the money saving part, if you can in your chat, if you have any idea in reference to how much money as of today that your college or university have saved students using OER, if we would love to give you a shout out, if you can put that in your chat.
Okay, we have a few comments here. One, first of all, from Bridget, that says, I'm curious to learn about how those cost savings numbers are calculated, if anyone has a source and how they could share that.
Okay.
Kelsey from West Hills College, Lemoore, says $6.5 million since 2017.
Awesome.
Liz says we don't have any way to track how much money our members have saved students yet. I wish we had a way to track this. Liz, I have some ideas about that. Wade, you're just commenting back. Jacqueline, 1.5 million since 2022.
Awesome. And Andrew, do you want to share in reference to the calculation part, or you want to, just in case other people would like to know, or would you like to get back in touch with her at a later time?
Oh, I can get in contact at a later time. Okay. I want to take time with your presentation. Okay. I'm happy to stay after too and answer questions. Okay.
I just want to make sure that she has the information that she needs.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you so much, Andrew. I appreciate that. Okay, so we said one of the advantages that OER has provided is through the use of education, through textbook costs, money savings, and also our innovative techniques. The next advantage that we need to discuss is employment. Guys, the U.S. Department of Labor Trade Adjustment Assistance Community College and Career Training is a grant training program that offers training in our workforce in order to assist with employment needs. You know, we've always focused upon the academic side in reference to, when I say academic, I mean degree. Our textbooks have always focused upon that side, but we're missing a whole nother side of our society. And I'm so glad to know that we are now focusing on this side as well, because they're just important as academic certification and academic. We're just providing what we need to for society, making it an equitable society. We just want to make sure that society has employable people. So with us providing academic textbooks as well as the workforce information is exactly what OER mission is. So skillscommon.org is a site where you can find information and trainable program information pertaining to, for example, information in reference to construction, computer operation, healthcare, manufacturing. And this training is also very important to our disadvantaged population, especially women and our blue-collar workers. So OER, again, is not only do we have academic work, but we also have workforce training development work. And again, with employment, that is our goal. We are providing an equitable, giving the disadvantaged population an opportunity to have equitability in their society. The last portion of my presentation is about sharing. And that's what we do in reference to the OER community, right? Our five R's talks about that, how we can basically take something, revise it, you know, and do everything else we need to it in order to make sure that we share it. With that being said, we can share this through what I'm going to talk about the first part, town and gown. When we're talking about sharing, I want us to look at not only our community, I want us to look at our institutional outreach as well as our government outreach. Our community and our institutional outreach is town and gown. We need to move outside of our platform at this time, because when you are in a room where everybody knows exactly what you're talking about, that means that it's time for you to move around. It means, when I say move around, that means it's time for you to share your knowledge with other people. So it's time for us to go out in our community. I've just given you two examples in reference to how open educational resources not only affects our academic platform, but it also affects our certification platform. Why can we not go out into our businesses, our local businesses, and let them know about the materials that where we can provide internships with our colleges, work on internships in order to help them with their businesses, in order to let them know that when our students graduate either with a certification or a degree, how it can help the community, how it can help their jobs. It is time for us to, again, to reach another platform so we are able to utilize our information in order to help them. And an exchange is just going to be a bartering system. If we can help them utilize our free resources, they then can pledge more money in order to help us to pay for faculty's members' utilization and creation of information, provide instructional resources, instructional designers, additional funding in order to help with creating new resources, provide more professional development. So this town and gown basically focuses on how we can go out in its community and how our institution can basically provide these businesses additional employment and better employment. And another way that we can share is through our government. When I say share with our government, that means that, guys, we need to reach out to our local as well as our national governments pertaining to open educational resources and how we can help our employment needs as well as our educational needs. Sparks has an OER related policy tracking, which will keep you abreast of current legislation sessions pertaining to our OER community. If you're not sure in reference to how to find out, you know, utilize that, utilize their information in order to help you to find out about legislative needs. Because again, remember that if we share this information in reference to what OER is doing and what our future plans are, again, that's the only way we can continue to grow. And that is what we have to do. We have to get out of our grassroots mentality because we're not grassroots anymore. I know that some people get offended when I say we're not grassroots because we're not. We're publishers, traditional publishers are competing against us. We're in a whole different arena. Okay, so we're not playing arena ball anymore. We're in the NFL and the NBA right now. Okay, so those of you who may be sports fans, we're playing against the Lakers right now. And we're playing against Boston Celtics right now. I mean, this is the arena that we're in right now. And when I talk about sharing, not only sharing on the outside, but guys, look at your institution. And if there's someone that you have not met or told about at your school about open educational resources, that means you need to walk up and say, hello, my name is Tanja Connolly and I'm one of the OER representative. And I heard that you're teaching statistics and OpenStax has a new statistic book. Or my name is Tanja Connolly, OpenStax has a new nursing program, a nursing book that's coming out. And I know that you have a new BSN program in your college. I just wanna email you some information if that's okay. Our traditional publishers, they have everyone. They have separate. They have book reps that come and knock on your door. They have the publishers. They have the editors. They have the reviewers. We're all of them. So we have to change hats and we have to do that. By attending OER conferences, guys, you are not only networking and learning and sharing, and that's exactly what OER is about. So on our CCC OER website, we have different conferences that you can attend where you can learn information and also, you know, get involved, do a presentation in reference to a different topic or something, get out of your box a little bit, do research on a new topic or attend a conference in order so you can learn about different things, because there's so much that we haven't really tapped into. And with that being said, I am going to end our presentation by giving you a challenge. And I don't mean to point my finger at you because I know it's rude, but what will you do in our OER community to help the disadvantaged? That is what I'm challenging you for. And with that being said, I really want to thank you guys for your time today. And I'm hoping that you can join our Open Ed 23 conference, March the 7th through the 9th. On Monday, we will start taking proposals for this conference. And our conference is entitled Innovation and Practice. And guys, the reason that we selected you, we've all selected because it was a vote in our community, is because we have to continue to grow. And again, we really introduced the innovation of open pedagogy to our traditional publishers. And they are literally following our bandwagon. And we want them to continue to follow us. We don't ever want to get in a point that we are following them. So join us if you can again at our conference, Open Educational Resources Conference 23, November the 7th through the 9th. Again, thank you for your time today. And I have a couple of minutes for questions if anybody has any questions.
Thank you so much, Tanja. That was
thank you.
That was amazing. Lots of great ideas there. And as always, lots of great quotes too. I'll be quoting from you. Thank you. if you have any questions, like, feel free to unmute and just ask directly.
Yeah, please don't hesitate. And you can always shoot me an email anytime.
Right. I want to thank Tanja today for her presentation. I appreciate the call to action that you presented to us. It's very thought-provoking for me, and it makes me think about whether I am, you know, my initiative is addressing all of the disadvantaged groups that you highlighted today, and whether or not I'm doing enough outreach in my area. So thank you so much for that. Very thought-provoking. And I wish we had more time for a discussion. I would like to take just a couple of minutes to more of your time to share about our summer book club. So on behalf of the EDI committee and Andrea Scott, co-VP, and myself, I would like to invite you all to attend our summer book club. We recently announced the community selected title, Origin Stories, Pathways to the Open Movement, which is a retelling of the personal and professional experiences of six women of color who are leaders in the open education movement. And so this is a free CC licensed text. There is a link there. The book club begins in June, and we have some links below on the slide. We do have an interest form that we invite you to submit. Either if you are interested in attending the book club, we will be sure to contact you. We are also soliciting facilitators for the book club. And so if you might be interested in being a facilitator, please just submit your interest using the form. It's not a commitment. We will be having a facilitator training in May. And so you can learn more about the book club, the EDI committee, as well as the facilitator training by going to our EDI committee webpage. Next slide. So we have a couple of upcoming webinars to close out the year. April 12th, we have the Open Education and Community Impact webinar. And on May 10th, the Transformative Power of OER and ZTC Pathways webinar. So please be on the lookout for those webinars and add them to your calendar. Next slide. Tanja mentioned going to the CCC OER website, looking for upcoming conference information. Please join the community email if you haven't already, and please go to see our EDI blog posts and student OER impact stories. Next slide. And please fill out a survey today to let us know what you thought about our presentation today. And on behalf of CCC OER, Andrea Scott, Tanja Connerly, and first and foremost, Liz Yatta, thank you so much for attending our webinar today. Have a great rest of your Open Education Week, and I hope you have a very relaxing weekend. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.